の SFX ゴールデン R。
In some way, I've always felt like this channel was going in this direction. If you've been a fan of my channel, you know how much I found interest in shoot style as a form of wrestling, with how mechanically stripped down it is, the sudden explosive violence that can erupt within, and the genuine unpredictability of how matches can end. And with shows like Josh Barnett's Bloodsport every year, and even this summer, with Josh Barnett's Bloodsport Bushido, bringing Barnett's ode to the style back to Japan, where its glory days took place. And it's hard to not feel even the slightest bit excited about this, bringing in a new appreciation of the style of wrestling. But I understand that the style isn't for everyone, but to me, I feel like it's important as a wrestling fan to experiment and step outside of your comfort zone and be curious about the art form around you, not just to make you realize what you've been missing out on or what initially made you love wrestling to begin with, but just maybe find appreciation in something you never would have expected. And to me, shoot style has become such a fascinating style of wrestling that I want to explore more of. But why should you care about shoot style? As an outsider looking in, you probably look at shoot style, most specifically what Josh Barnett brings to the table with Bloodsport, and think, wow, that sounds super corny. If I wanted to watch wrestling act like it was real, I'd just watch MMA. To which I would respond, one,
I'm deciding to take that personally.
And two, I feel like that's a force to the tree's understanding of what shoot style really is. I think I appreciate shoot style a lot for a few specific reasons. One, I think, given the specific rules that shoot style exists within, whether that's the way point systems are implemented in the UWF, UWFI, or Fighting Network rings, adds a sense of drama where stories can naturally occur over people coming back from disadvantages, people getting desperate and risky with their offense, and the spontaneous, oftentimes unpredictable outcomes that can occur that you wouldn't regularly see in MMA or pro wrestling. Second, the way style clashes can occur where a grappler has to face a striker, or one wrestler who has a severe weight advantage over the other. For example, in my Vader Takata video, I made great detail over how even though Vader had no business being in a legitimate shoot competition, given his style is dropping you on your head and or moonsaulting all 400 pounds of himself over the top rope, was able to make the match work by using his superior size and striking to smother Takata and keep Takata grounded, forcing him to escape and wrestle his match. The excitement and drama coming from how Takata can use his legitimate wrestling background and signature kicks to chop down the much larger and stronger monster. Third, I really appreciate the meticulousness of shoot style. It's not defined by the traditional pro wrestling structure of heel heat segments, babyface comebacks, and exciting finishing stretches like normal wrestling, but more on intricate and stripped down details. The way a wrestler applies a hold, the constant motion in which wrestlers think their way out of said holds, the precision of a well-placed strike, and the satisfaction that goes into just one basic slam that endless amounts of struggle went into. Yes, because they're trying to present their wrestling as legitimate as possible, but also because there is so much effort put into making the most basic moves look painful and difficult to escape. And when something big is hit or a rope break occurs, it feels all the more exciting, dramatic, and well-earned. For example, in a 1992 match between Akira Maeda and Volk Han in rings, both Han and Maeda are in a leg lock. Anywhere else, this might be a transition into another hold or spot, but here, they commit so hard to the hold in order to make it feel dangerous, as both men are constantly trying to maneuver out of it and test each other's toughness to see who loses a point by rope break. And awaiting who gives first leads you on the edge of your seat, because that struggle was made so palpable. And finally, It cannot be understated how genuinely entertaining the various wrestlers and personalities of Shoot Style are in and of themselves, removed from the actual matches. I swear, there is no form of wrestling that houses some of the biggest petty bad boys and bag-chasing carnies the way Shoot Style does. I guess it just makes sense that when you present yourself as the realist form of something in martial arts and wrestling, that egos are going to be inflated and genuine spite is going to form. Whether that was Akira Maeda beefing with Satoru Sayama in the original UWF that culminated in Maeda kicking Sayama so hard in the dick that it soon after ended the whole promotion, to Nobuhiko Takada trying to recreate Inoki vs. Ali with Trevor Burbick, where Burbick believed that kicks below the waist were illegal, only to have Takada kick his legs into powder, winning the match after Burbick left the ring in protest. So much about Shoot Style is just so fascinating to me that I want to share it all with you. So let today's video be the first in a series of videos. If Joseph Montecelio has Walking the King's Road and Chris O'Brien has Learning Lucha, let this be Shoot Studies. Class is in session. Before we get into today's topic, I'd like to lay down some ground rules as a means of not only alleviating some confusion, but also apologizing for some mistakes that I made in my past videos, and make sure that I hold myself accountable as someone who's a fan of and wants to discuss this style. Number one, no, Pancrase and Shudo are not Shoot Style. In my Vader Takada and Ikeda Ishikawa videos, I was initially confused by calling Pancrase and Shudo Shoot Style, as they had rosters, primarily Pancrase, that held former wrestlers who competed in Shoot Style promotions. Minoru Suzuki, Masakatsu Funaki, and Ken Shamrock all being in Pro Wrestling Fujiwara Gumi before forming Pancrase. In Pancrase, they promoted themselves as legitimate fighters, more specifically hybrid wrestling, strictly considering themselves as an MMA promotion. My apologies for that slip up in my previous videos, but I wanted to state that those two promotions are indeed not Shoot Style to remove any confusion I gave initially. Additionally, as much as I love it, no, Battle Arts is not a Shoot Style promotion. If you watched my previous video essay on Ishikawa and Ikeda, you might be confused given how their matches resemble a traditional Shoot Style bout, and indeed, both men came from a Shoot Style promotion in Pro Wrestling Fujiwara Gumi, but it's important to delineate the difference between the two as Battle Arts and the Bocce Bocce style is not comparable to the Shoot Style of UWF, UWFI, or Rings. Shoot Style of Rings and UWFI, for example, was less focused on trying to be the pro wrestling and used the sport of wrestling to speculate a sport that didn't exist yet to prove itself as a legitimate martial art against other martial arts, even implementing point systems to make them feel like they were closer to a sport than their contemporaries, whereas Battle Arts in its Bocce Bocce style wanted to push pro wrestling as hard-hitting, painful, and emotional as it can be against other forms of pro wrestling, while preserving the pro wrestling match structure. So, With all that out of the way when considering my first topic, I was really spoiled for choice on what to discuss first. Initially, I came down to three different qualities that might draw in a curious viewer. Number one, I wanted the match to be brief, say under 10 minutes so as to not bore someone with a match that needed a lot of investment of their time. Which leads me to number two, a match that's exciting, something with constant movement and scrappiness as to excite them into being drawn into the struggle of the match. And three, a match that doesn't need any previous investment or knowledge of previous matches in order to get the story of the match. And with that considered,
but you don't hear me though.
Hell yeah, man. This shit means something to me, man. So, while I did say that there's no prior knowledge needed in order to appreciate this match, I think it does help a bit by having some kind of knowledge of both men here. Tatsuo Nakano, for most of his wrestling career, whether that was being an OG member of the UWF promotion from 1984 to 1985, or being in New Japan as somewhat of a young boy from 1986 to 1988, where he had a positive showing in the 1987 Young Lion Cup, facing the likes of future Three Musketeers alumni Shinya Hashimoto and Masahiro Chono, never really feels like he's going to be a top star. He consistently loses to rising stars and established talent, and by the time the UWF returns as UWF Newborn in 1988, he's in an ocean of top talent like Nobuhiko Takada, Akira Maeda, Yoshiaki Fujiwara, and worst of all, the Golden Boy. Ripped to the gills, flowing hair, athletic stud, Masakatsu Funaki. Funaki was in New Japan around the same time as Nakano, and even in a New Japan class that had the likes of Shinya Hashimoto and Jushin Liger, Funaki was already being praised as the next top star of New Japan. In the aforementioned 1987 Young Lion Cup, Funaki actually beat Nakano, and by the end of the tournament, finished his run with 30 points in comparison to Nakano's 20. And because of that, by the time both men jump ship to UWF Newborn, you can definitely sense a level of professional resentment that Nakano has for Funaki, which by the time they finally have a match against each other in UWF Newborn, that resentment finally boils over, and Nakano wants a fight. The opening moments of this match perfectly establish the level of spite Nakano has for Funaki. Funaki offers a hand to Nakano, who immediately kicks it away, and it is on. You see, it's easy for Funaki to show respect and be humble when he is on top and Nakano is on the bottom, and Funaki has the confidence of a company behind him. Nakano, on the other hand, has nothing to lose and everything to prove against Funaki. He must prove to the higher ups that he belongs with the top of the heap. And he's not here for a spect or an exhibition. He is here to beat Funaki's ass. And following this disrespect from Nakano, immediately sees both Nakano and Funaki swing for the fences on each other with such wild and chaotic energy that the crowd goes absolutely rabid for. I can't truthfully confirm how many people were in the arena. Cage Match states that the venue for the show, the now-closed Hakata Star Lanes in Fukuoka, has a capacity of 4,000, but however many people there felt like it was triple that, as everyone lives and dies on how hard Nakano fights Funaki here. The crowd is completely behind him. No matter how much Funaki blasts Nakano with shoot kicks and slaps, Nakano just keeps coming and coming. Which leads me into Nakano's greatest strength as a wrestler, his perseverance. To quote Phil Schneider of the Secunda Caeta blog and Way of the Blade podcast, the episode he does with Jonathan Snowden on the match in question I used to help research this video, shout out to those guys, Tatsuo Nakano is a great pace pusher. Whether that's matches against Takada, Suzuki, or even Super Vader, Nakano is always pushing the pace of the match, never settling, always scrambling and fighting his way out of holds, and every time he gets hit, always comes back on the offensive. To hell with Chris Benoit, Tatsuo Nakano is the real Rabid Wolverine. It helps keep the pace of any match he's in constantly exciting and engaging, as opposed to just settling into a leg lock sequence for minutes on end. Unfortunately, the damage Funaki does to Nakano does catch up to him after a shoot kick absolutely shatters Nakano's nose to atoms, becoming far too much of a worry for the officials and doctor, and the match stops momentarily, and just listen to the crowd when Nakano is cleared. Bloody and battered, Nakano does the most badass thing and genuinely bad idea ever in a fight, and just blows blood out of his nose. The Mist of Crimson still being on full display despite the quality of the tape. Truthfully, if you come out of this match with one thought, it should be how much of a badass Tatsuo Nakano is. But for Funaki's part, he gives just as much as he takes. Funaki is more than willing to trade blows with Nakano, and perhaps with more precision, as the aforementioned shoot kick to Nakano's nose does help to impede Nakano's breathing, as following the blow, the drama of when, rather than if, Nakano will lose sets in. In the slowest part of the match, the two men eventually settle into a leg lock sequence, but it's earned here, as each man needs their stamina back after such a hellacious onslaught in the opening minutes. And even still, Nakano never settles, and consistently tries to work his way out of it to the delight of the crowd, as once Nakano gets vertical, is back to punishing Funaki with slaps and kicks, leading to the first down near fall of the match. Nakano tries to end it as soon as he can by nailing Funaki with a beautiful double underhook suplex and tries to get an armbar attempt, but once Funaki fights out of it, Nakano goes to the well once more with another dragon screw. But well, let's just say, never powerbomb Billy Kidman, never go off the top rope against Samoa Joe, and going forward, never dragon screw Masakatsu Funaki, as he stomps Nakano's head in, and credit to Nakano here, refuses to relent and keeps a hold on Funaki, trying to ground him as much as possible, but a hellacious heel kick and suplex flattens Nakano for another down near fall, the first for Nakano in this match. Funaki tries a single leg Boston Crab to try and force a submission victory, and the crowd erupts for Nakano to make it to the ropes. And Nakano persists, but the damage has already started to catch up with Nakano, as the ringside doctor, referee, and even his stablemate intervene to stop Nakano, as the blood continues to trickle from Nakano's nose, where Funaki has hardly attained any serious damage. The more the match continues, the less it favors Nakano, and once he's given the okay to continue, if he is to win here, he needs to end this immediately. And then Nakano swings for the fences with a duo of roundhouse kicks for Funaki's second down, and continues to drop him with kicks, putting Funaki on the back foot with another down. The crowd continues to cheer Nakano on, as victory seems within his grasp. But whether it's Nakano getting too comfortable with his kicks, or Funaki smartening up on Nakano's offense, catches his kicks into a rolling Alabama slam, followed with a wrenching Boston Crab, submitting Nakano, finally putting the fiery fighter away at 9 minutes and 4 seconds. while for many people who watch this match for the first time may see it as nothing more than a chaotic, violent scrap, and it is, I think there's something genuinely great about the character work and storytelling at play here. Nakano is infectiously likable here. He is never on the back foot, constantly applying pressure on Funaki as to where he may not have the precise technique and skill as Funaki, but more than makes up for it by overwhelming Funaki to force a flash knockout or anger Funaki into slipping up and using it to his advantage. Also, in moments where Nakano is being forced to stop the match as the damage catches up to him, he's still pushing back the ref and doctors to get back at Funaki, proving that his spirit is more than capable of continuing even if his body isn't. A trademark quality that endears anyone to a wrestler, and you genuinely believe that he can beat Funaki, as the deeper the match goes, he shows great desperation, as his offense becomes more hellacious, and accrues more downs than Funaki in this match. Funaki, on his part, plays the match just as violent, but there's a stronger sense of precision and tact in how he figures Nakano out. His strikes land with purpose, as each slap, stomp, kick, and headbutt try to disorient and even break Nakano's face to impede his breathing, making it harder for Nakano to tap into that faster pace with his offense. Remember, if you can't breathe, you can't fight. But what I love most about Funaki's performance here is that despite where they are on the pecking order, he's always taking Nakano seriously. You can see it in the way he frantically stomps at Nakano to get off his leg and uses a variety of ways to try and put him away. Whether that's attempting a submission or a knockout, he treats Nakano as this puzzle that he needs to slowly and surely solve, and once he's able to play the long game and drag Nakano to deep waters, uses Nakano's violence against him to land a devastating move. It makes both men come away looking far better than they were before. Nakano as a never-say-die fighter who refuses to stay down and be looked down upon, even at the caution of the officials. And Funaki as this careful and thoughtful wrestler who, despite whatever violence he dishes out and receives, uses it to his advantage and is able to use it against his opponent. On this night, while Masakatsu Funaki may have been the victor in the record books, Tatsuo Nakano won in the hearts of the Hakata Star Lanes fans. While 1989 is a year for wrestling, he is mythicized as the single greatest year in Ric Flair's career in the Steamboat Trilogy and I Quit match with Terry Funk, the establishment of the Triple Crown in All Japan, and the Mega Powers exploding, but to name a few, don't you dare sleep on Masakatsu Funaki versus Tatsuo Nakano in UWF Newborn. Because if you do, what you miss out on is the single most aggressive, violent, and scrappy match of the whole year, and a perfect kind of introduction to the excitement and struggle you can find in shoot style. Pure, unadulterated shoot excellence. Ah, but all this is but one kind of story that shoot style as a style of wrestling can offer, and whatever promotion, match, and pure fighting spirit we may find in our next lesson, Shoot Studies will be here, more than willing to share and enlighten. Class dismissed.